I lost my mom in 2008, and she committed suicide. I was 16.
Were you angry with her? Were you conscious of all that then, or looking back now, do you realize that?
Looking back now.
Yeah.
And I was so caught up in myself that I missed. I missed so much.
So the moment you realized my mother took her life was when?
I lost all the feeling in my body. I had an amazing blueprint of what a good mother should be.
If you're noticing that there's a plan in action, that's when it's the most lethal at times.
Nearly 800,000 people take their own life every single year. That's nearly one person every 40 seconds. It is an unfortunate reality that has plagued many, and it's actually the second leading cause of death in this country. You may question, what gets someone to the point that they feel they want to end it all? And I don't know that I can answer that. What I do know is that they were just like you and I, with a life, family, dreams, and goals. And that was the case for today's guest, whose mother took her own life about 12 years ago, and she has agreed to sit down and tell her story.
Kiara Herring was born in a suburban town outside Chicago to two wonderful parents, Cedric and Marsha Herring. Growing up, Kiara had a childhood that embodied what she describes as the Cosby family lifestyle, a two-parent household where she often played tennis with her dad and went to Girl Scout meetings with her mom. On the outside looking in, they had the perfect life, but inside, things were unraveling.
Welcome, Kiara.
Hi.
I'm excited to have you.
Oh, I'm so excited to be here.
Yeah.
So excited to be here.
How do you feel?
I feel good.
Yeah.
I feel like this is going to be worth the conversation.
Yeah, yeah. And you look amazing.
Thank you. I'm just trying to keep up.
I wasn't worried about you coming and how you was going to look. That's right. That's one thing. To be honest, for me, this morning as I was coming, I said, wow, this is at the heartbeat of why I wanted to have these conversations. I think it's really important. And so I was a little anxious because wanting to do your mother's story justice,
right?
But also be mindful of this probably is really heavy. What was your thoughts coming this morning?
I prayed.
Mm.
Just not just for strength, because that comes with time, but the ability to speak how I feel freely,
yeah,
without holding myself back or being concerned about how things may sound or how things may look,
yeah,
or being judged, or
yeah,
just telling my story to hopefully help someone else.
Right. So. I love that. You said strength comes with time. Do you, as time has went on, has it become easier to talk about?
Every day is different.
Yeah.
Every day is completely different. Every month is different. Every year is different. Mm. Every anniversary is, yeah, different. It just depends.
Yeah.
Some days are fine, and other days it's like you're back in that moment. So
yeah,
with time things get better, but sometimes it's,
yeah,
the same.
Is it hard to acknowledge when you say, or you think about my mother? I think for anyone whose mother, anyone they know, passes away, it's obviously very hard. Is it different when the person took their, or how different is it when the person almost made a decision to leave?
So I've lost both my parents.
Mm.
I lost my mom in 2008, and she committed suicide. Mm. I was 16. And then at 26, in 2018, my dad had a massive heart attack, like out of nowhere, and passed. Mm. I look at the two completely differently.
Wow.
As a parent, as a mother, there's nothing on this earth that I could imagine that would keep me from my son.
Hmm.
And while I've had conversations with myself, and at a certain point had really contemplated suicide myself, knowing that I'm here for someone else keeps me from, it always kept me from going too far down that path.
Yeah.
Always worrying about my family or worrying about, you know,
yeah,
other things. So it's very different when you think about a decision that someone made that affects more than just themselves.
Yeah. Are you angry at her? Were you angry with her?
I was angry for a while. Mm. I was confused. I was hurt. It took a lot of growing to really understand and empathize. I think that was my biggest thing. I think once I could get to a place where I was able to put myself in her shoes, I think it made it a little bit easier. It kind of helped ease the pain. It kind of helped ease the anger. So.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Putting yourself in her shoes, what does that mean when you think about that?
Ooh, she had a lot going on. My parents, I don't want to go too far into detail because it's a longer story. Mm-hmm. My parents were married for 26 years. Mm-hmm. She, for the whole 26 years, had a very severe alcohol problem. It was hidden very well from my brother and I. Growing up, we had amazing childhoods. Like, we had the Cosby lifestyle, like the Cosby Show family lifestyle. Great, strong two-parent home. And in my eyes and looking back on it, everything was perfect just because so much was buried and hidden. So that put a strain on their relationship, just dealing with the alcoholism. And then, I mean, just day-to-day trials and, you know, issues with marriage and whatever. At a certain point, my dad decided to leave, which I won't say caused my mother's drinking to get worse, but at the time, it became severely worse. Mm-hmm. She became really depressed, and just kind of spiraled from that point. Mm-hmm. Like, the depression led to drinking. The drinking led to more depression. She couldn't get out of bed. She started missing days of work, missed so many days of work. She ended up getting fired. Once she got fired, bills stopped going paid. Like, you know, bills mm-hmm. weren't getting paid. And it just all, they were about to foreclose on the house. Like, there was a lot. It was a lot. I was 16 and irritating and thought that the world revolved around me, as most 16-year-olds do. There was a lot going on.
Were you conscious of all that then, or looking back now?
Looking back now.
Yeah.
Looking back now, because again, I mean, and it's different for men. Well, in most cases for men and their mothers in teenage years. For girls, like, I thank God every day I have a son, because I know the headache that I was for my parents, and I know how difficult that relationship was. I feel like most teenage girls go through a phase where it's like, oh, I can't stand my parents, and honestly, I'm sure as parents, they'd be like, I can't stand her neither. But eventually, it all comes full circle.
Yeah.
Like, once you get older, absolutely, you start to appreciate that relationship a lot more.
Yeah.
And I mean, we were at the peak of, like, there was a lot of animosity. And in hindsight, there was never anything to have really argued about. Like, it was petty teenage. I mean, we always think that the world is ending every week when we're teenagers. But I feel like I was so focused on myself. And I was so caught up in myself that I missed so much.
And I try so hard not to blame myself because, like I said, I was 16 and I'm okay. I'm fine. I was 16. So there wasn't, most 16-year-olds can't get out of their own head. Most 16-year-olds don't have the capability to pay attention to the things that matter because we're caught up in 16-year-old life. So I couldn't tell you what I was doing or what I cared about or who was important at that time. But whatever I was caught up in, it wasn't what I needed to be caught up in. Mm-hmm. So I'm sorry, I went off on a tangent. Mm-hmm. So she, like I said, there was a lot going on and it just got to be too much. Once she was fired from her job, she took time to like volunteer down at our church, and that's where she spent the majority of her time. So she was going on job interviews and stuff like that. So there was a lot of time that like she'd be in and out of the house, or you know, she'd be off doing her own thing, and I was 16. I was just happy for the space.
Yeah.
And I remember the day so vividly, like down to almost every detail.
Walk us through that day.
It kind of spans over 2 days. Mm. Me being 16 and thought I was cute, I was wearing my natural hair, mm-hmm. naturally curly. I have like a real black girl 4C hair texture, and that wasn't something that I normally did then. And she was so proud of me like embracing my natural hair and embracing, you know, my natural beauty. And she used to say like, oh, you got that good hair for me and blah, blah, blah. Like we'd just be joking back and forth. And she's like, well, what did you put in? And I'm like, I didn't put anything in. I put water in it. And the last time I saw her, I was in the bathroom putting water in my hair. And I was like, see, I told you I got that good hair. And we were just in the bathroom, like playing and laughing. And she gave, and it was a regular morning. I think it was like a Tuesday or Wednesday. I was on my way to school. I was just getting ready. And she came into my bathroom and she hugged me. And she had tears in her eyes. And it was this long hug. And I'm like, girl, what is wrong with you? Like, I figured like, okay, she must be coming on her cycle or something. Cause what is this? What is wrong with you? And I was just focused on, you know, myself.
Yeah.
And I ran, thank you. I ran out the door. I got a ride to school that day. And I think she was like, I love you. And I was just like, oh, okay, love you too, bye. And just kind of ran out the house, just assuming that it would be a normal day. I went to school that day. I had an after school activity. I needed a ride home. And I started calling her cell phone and I wasn't getting an answer. Eventually I got a ride home from a friend. Because I was like, okay, like, dang, lady, you could at least, like, shot me a text message or something, like, make sure I'm okay. Again, me being 16, just focusing on me and focusing on my needs and focusing on, you know, just petty little 16-year-old stuff. When I got home, I realized her phone was sitting on the counter and she turned it off. And I'm like, what? Like, my mother was very business oriented. And once she'd gotten fired, like she was still on hustle, like trying to find clients for this and trying to do this and trying to do that. So her cell phone was her lifeline. Like, and that's why I thought it was so weird that it's like, lady, I know you see me call. So at that point I felt ignored, because I'm like, I know you see me calling you. Like, I know that phone is in your hand. If it's not in your hand, it's in your purse. And your purse is in your hand. So you have to, I know you see me calling. And once I saw her cell phone on the counter, I was like, yo, something is off. Again, I didn't know that something was wrong, but it was very unusual for her to have just left it behind.
So the moment you realize my mother took her life was when?
The next day. She never came home. I stayed up all night calling everyone that I could think of, worried sick. I thought maybe she had been in an accident, or maybe like she'd had a drinking problem. Maybe she'd gotten like a DUI. She was in jail somewhere. It wasn't until the next morning my godmom convinced me to go to school. So I talked to my counselor at the time. We talked about everything, the alcoholism, the divorce, you know, them splitting up, like everything. And I felt so much better, because at that time it wasn't something that I was very vocal about. Yeah. Like, no one around me really knew what was going on. I felt like this huge weight had been lifted off of my shoulders. I was so happy. I was like, okay, we're gonna find her.
Yeah.
We're gonna, you know, like, everything's gonna be fine. We can do this, and we can get her into this counseling. And I had no idea. He sent me back to class. I was in class for no more than 5 minutes before they came and they took me into an office. And it was like my principal and some people I had never seen before. The same counselor that I had just spent an hour with, who had just told me that everything was going to be okay, and that my life would be back to normal, and that everything would be back on track. And there were these two police officers, and they grabbed my hand and they said, well, Kiara, we found your mom. And I said, oh, great. Where was she? Like, is she okay? Where the heck was she? And they said, no, Kiara, I don't even remember the exact words, but it was something like, no, we found her body. She wasn't in any pain. It was something, something, something. And at that moment, I didn't believe it. Like, I thought it was like some counseling trick, like worst case scenario, get it out of your system so you can be prepared for whatever the situation is.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, I thought it was like a trick. At that moment, my brother and like two other family friends come rushing through the door. And at that moment, once I saw my brother's face, it all set in. It all set in. And I lost all the feeling in my body. And I remember that moment so clearly, to sit beside yourself for a moment. And it was something that I had never experienced before. And to this day, it's something that luckily I haven't experienced since. It was unreal. Like, I didn't know how to process it. I had so many questions that I couldn't even formulate what I wanted to say. I was just hysterical.
The previous day would be the last time Kiara saw her mother. After days of family, friends, and local authority searching, her mother's body was found and rendered lifeless. Marsha Herring unfortunately passed away on September the 3rd, 2008. She had just celebrated her 50th birthday.
After that, for the next 6 years, is a blur, a complete blur, like a
from that moment to six, everything.
Yes,
after six.
Every from that moment, from I remember standing in the rain, and then it's like everything it's like a movie. It's like fade to black, and then the next scene I physically remember living is meeting my son's father for the first time. And that was 4 years later. Mm. Like everything in between then, it's a memory, but not a memory that I've experienced or that I've lived. I don't know how to explain it, but it feels like
an outer body.
Well, I mean, but yes, but it feels like a movie that I watched once, like a long time ago. Mm. And I don't know how else to explain it. Like, it's not like, do you remember when we met
at Hollister?
Yeah. Like, you remember working at Hollister. Yeah. Like, you remember, yeah, yeah, like, clocking in. I don't know what it is, but my life changed. Stopped. Stopped. I mean, and it's to the point that my life is categorized in two separate time periods. So it's like, if you say, oh, Kiara, we met in 2012, which I don't think we did, but if you say, okay, we met in August in 2012, my mind starts from the day she died, and then either I go forwards or backwards. Mm. Like, my life is in two periods. It's when my mom was alive and when she wasn't. Like, it's two, I feel like I've lived two separate lives. Yeah.
On September 26, 2014, Kiara gave birth to her only child, Kingston. Personally, I think motherhood is her sweet spot. And on set, my team and I were able to witness the kind of relationship she has with her son. And boy, is it magical.
Contrast, you have a son now.
Yes.
And so how do you compartmentalize when you think about it, you having a child? And knowing what your child means to you, how do you then compare that to, or is it even a comparison? Because I can imagine the moment when you met your son, you felt like you had, he was yours.
That, yeah.
Yeah.
And that's part of the reason why he's here, actually. Mm. I mean, because when I got pregnant young and there was a moment in time where I didn't know if that was what I wanted to do, but the love that, at least I felt like the love that I wasn't able to give my mom, mm, I can give it to him.
Yeah.
And I had an amazing mother, mm, an amazing blueprint of what a mother should be. And at 16, I didn't appreciate it. I mean, I knew she was a great mother. Don't get me wrong. Like I said, at 16, you just caught up in your own 16-year-old yeah, nonsense. But I had an amazing blueprint of what a good mother should be. Mm-hmm. So with my relationship with him, I do everything that I can to show, like, I was listening. Mm-hmm. Mom, like, what you did for me, I can do for him. And then when I get petty, what you did for me, I can do for him, and I won't leave him. That's still the hard part, because there is nothing on this earth that I wouldn't do for that boy. There is nothing on this earth that would make me leave him. Nothing. So to make that, and it feels so selfish, so I try my hardest not to think that way or not to feel that way. But now that I have a child, yeah, and I know that my mom loved me, that's not a question in yeah, my mind, but now that I have a child, it's almost jarring. Like, the sense of abandonment is different.
Mm. Yeah.
Once you see it from the other side.
Yeah. Well, I want to say this, you know, you and I worked at Hollister and we were younger, and I always adored you, right? And we lost touch for a couple of years,
right.
Went to college, and you know, life happens, and we reconnected when I moved back from Dallas. Mm-hmm. And the reason is because when I was in Dallas, I was going through a major depression that I didn't talk about with anybody. And to the point where it was so bad that I didn't recognize how bad it was because I was so far in it. My mom didn't know, my family didn't know, my friends didn't know. And I was suffering in silence. And then one day, I went to things got really bad financially. I wasn't working, heartbreak, et cetera, and so forth. And I went to the store one day in particular, and I picked up a bottle of pills. And I didn't know what I was going to do. I didn't know what I was going to do with it. I just picked them up. And then in that moment, I thought about what would my mother do if I wasn't here? And I thought about my little sister. And then I was in my car and I just started sobbing. Fast forward 2 days later, that's when you posted the picture of your mom and her anniversary. And when I moved back to Chicago, that was the reason why I called you. Because when you posted that, it let me know that it in some way made me feel as though, because I felt embarrassed to say that. I felt like I'm stronger than that.
Exactly.
I'm bigger than that, mm-hmm. You know? And so when I saw that picture, and that we had known each other for years, I didn't know that you had went through that. And so, one, I was like, how did I not know that? Because that happened after we were friends. And then when I came back, I called you and we had this conversation mm-hmm. at Chipotle. So thank you. I really, really do appreciate it. And let's take a break. Knowing we were going to have a really tough discussion, I thought it was really important that we had a professional here. And so Lauren Michelle Jackson is a licensed clinical professional counselor and certified life coach practicing in the mental health field for over 10 years. She's the owner of the mental health private practice, Cultivate Your Essence, located in the South Loop of Chicago. Cultivate Your Essence is dedicated to helping women foster a healthy relationship with themselves in order to improve their overall mental health, cultivating the life of their dreams. Their mission is to hold women accountable to living their absolute best life through fostering a healthy relationship with self first. So, Lauren, thank you for being here.
Thank you for having
me. Yeah. So, I just want to get right into it.
Yeah.
You heard the discussion that me and Kiara had. And
yeah.
How normal is this?
Unfortunately, it's becoming very normal in today's society.
Yeah.
You know, typically you'll start to see men having more suicidal ideations but actually completing the suicide.
Mm.
But women are right behind as well.
Yeah.
One of the things we talk about the most is that when people get to this place, a suicide, it really was something that they've been contemplating
yeah.
prior to getting there.
Yeah.
Nobody wakes up in the morning and say, okay, today's the day. Mm-hmm. There's a lot of different factors that typically go into it where a person, it's not so much they want to kill themselves, it's to the place where they have literally gotten to, there's nothing else here that I feel can help me.
They want the pain to stop.
They want the pain to stop by any means necessary. And when we see, you know, taking into account even family, children, and people that they leave behind, in some ways it almost shows how much of pain they're really in for them to take those things into consideration and still follow through with it.
Yeah.
So, you know, it unfortunately we're seeing it in higher levels, even in the Black community especially.
Yeah, yeah. Do you think that one of the biggest reasons is because people, there's a stigma that if someone takes their own life, that something was wrong, something was wrong with them. Like they were not well in the head. But
right.
I think people have the misconception that it can happen to anyone, and waiting until it gets so bad is usually the problem, is because people don't feel comfortable in saying, I need help.
Right.
Right.
And I think also too, there's such a stigma around it. People don't know how to have the conversations around it. Right.
Yeah.
So a lot of times, unfortunately, the things I've heard is people do it for attention, you know, or, you know, they're crazy, or they've always been like that since they were little. And it's kind of just like you've put, by saying these things, you've almost placed them in such a position. Why would they feel comfortable sharing their story if they don't feel like they're going to be taken seriously? There's no real support. It's not safe to really talk about it with anybody. And then on top of it, if A lot of times too, if there's been a history of that in the family too,
yeah,
that's another reason why for them to think that it's okay to go ahead and do so, because such and such have already done so. So why shouldn't I as well?
Yeah, yeah. Do you think your mom was ashamed to say that she was hurting or wanted or needed?
My mother always tried to put on like a face, a facade.
Yeah.
It's like, I'm fine, everything is fine. And I think that's why, like, she was able to mask the issues that she had well before she committed suicide. Like, to hide the alcoholism, to hide the problems in the marriage, to hide money issues. Mm. I mean, I think it was very deeply ingrained in her that no matter what, you put your best face forward.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So I feel like someone in her position just wasn't able to admit that she needed help.
Yeah. Is that the problem though, Lauren? Mm-hmm. When people say, I have to put on the face, is that not the biggest, and correct me if I'm wrong, is that not the biggest, because how I see it is, if someone is comfortable to say, you know, taking it back to the story I said, when I saw the picture, it normalized, okay, I should seek help, I should ask for help, and nothing is wrong with me if I say anything, because I mean, ultimately, don't we all need help?
Yeah, we all do. At some point in time, we do. And I think it is easier to live behind the facade because nobody's going to question you.
Right. Mm. Nobody knows but you.
Exactly. Mm. So, again, that gives me another sense of power and control over myself to be able to control the narrative of my own story.
Right.
And to a certain degree, you're trying to buy into that yourself, right? Yeah. So this is the facade. This is who I'm presenting myself to the world. This is who I want the world to see. And eventually, I'm trying to catch up to whatever that narrative I'm trying to create.
Fake it till you make it.
Wow, wow. Which is a very common thread, and especially particularly in the Black community.
Definitely.
How do you notice the signs if someone in your life is struggling? Because I think also a big stigma or a misconception is that if someone is suffering, I'll know. But many times, right?
No, you would have no idea. A lot of times you wouldn't know, especially if they're putting on that mask, right?
Yeah.
But then you'll start to notice certain little things where the withdrawing from people a little bit more, right? You're starting to notice they're getting their affairs in order differently, right? So what I mean by that is they may be giving away certain things. They may start putting together wills or things of that nature. And here's the thing. We know that that's a common practice.
Yeah.
But at the same time, have you been noticing any depressive symptoms? Have you been noticing that the fact that with the withdrawal, there's almost certain things, like they're saying their goodbyes in certain like cold languages, right?
What's a depressive symptom? Explain those.
A depressive symptom could be, we like to think of it as like extreme sadness, right?
Yeah.
But what it is that it's persistent to the fact that we can't shake it. We all go through depressive episodes. Let's be very clear, because depression is no different than anxiety. It's no different than feeling happy or sad. We all go through them at some point in time, but it's how long are these depressive episodes happening, right?
Yeah.
So you want to pay attention to those factors as well. And then another thing we really want to pay attention to is that there's a certain code language that people may be trying to signal out for help, but they may not just have the words to talk about it, right? Yeah. So they might have been just saying, you know, I've been just thinking, what if I, you know, took a long trip, or maybe, you know, just took some time for myself, when there's some things that have been going on already, and paying attention to different things that we could consider trauma, right? Drug abuse and alcohol as well. If that's starting to increase a little bit more, especially if that wasn't something that you saw in the beginning, paying attention to little things like that as well.
Yeah.
But unfortunately, the biggest thing that we have to do is we have to normalize these conversations.
Yeah.
Because a lot of times we'll sit here and we'll try to tiptoe around everybody's emotions. But the biggest thing is, especially me as a therapist, if I'm picking up on something, I have to call it out. So if you're noticing that there's a plan in action, that's when it's the most lethal at times, right? I've already thought about it. I've already thought of how I'm going to do it. Now it's just a matter of if I'm actually going to commit to it.
Yeah.
You know? So it's paying attention to those little things.
What if you've known someone? Because I think last time me and Kiara spoke, she said she felt, and correct me if I'm wrong, there's a little bit of guilt that you had in feeling like in some ways you had a you felt guilty for not noticing or felt guilty for...
Oh, that's not a little bit of guilt. That's a lot of bit of guilt. That's a lot.
Yeah.
And that's still something that I struggle with. Yeah. Like, even having this conversation right now.
Yeah.
Just as you go through the signs, like, I can recall, like, yep, that. And angry with myself that I didn't catch that then.
Yeah. But I think the biggest thing is you can't blame yourself for that.
Yeah.
As hard as it is, unless you're even a trained professional like myself, you wouldn't know, right?
Yeah.
You're just trying to go through the motions. And again, Kiara, right? You mentioned being a teenager and just being self-absorbed. I mean, that's normal. Yeah. It's teenager stuff, right? Because mentally, our brains don't even develop until we're 25. So you didn't even have the foresight to know anything like that, right? So it's taking those things into consideration. When people are making this choice, it has nothing to do with anybody else.
Right.
It is their own internal struggle that they've been dealing with for a long period of time before they even shared it with anybody else.
Yeah.
So, you know, it's for them, it's the one thing that they feel like they do have control over.
Mm.
And being able to take that time to say, this is what I want to do for me.
Yeah.
As crazy it might sound, that's the most courageous thing that they actually could do. And we try to prevent it at all costs, but for them, that was the one thing that they had control over.
Wow, wow.
And I know that's a lot.
Yeah, but it's necessary to say. Kiara, what would you, if anything, would you want to say to your mom if you had the opportunity? What would you want her to know about you?
I don't think there's nothing that she doesn't see or that she doesn't, you know?
Yeah.
I mean, my son, it's almost weird.
Yeah.
Like the things that he mentions or like the things that he says. And I'm a firm believer that like she's still around and she makes herself known. I get signs and clues and hints and stuff like that.
Mm.
Surprises on my birthdays and, you know, little stuff that in the grand scheme of things may seem so small, but when you've lost someone that way, those tiny little signs from the universe, it's like, oh, you're thinking about me.
Yeah.
Dreams and, you know, stuff like that. Yeah. So
I can say I know your mom is extremely proud of you, of the person that you've become.
Thank you.
How thoughtful you are, the mother that you've become, and how beautiful you are inside and out. And thank you for doing this. This is going to help a lot of people. Thank you, Lauren.
No problem.
Thank you, Kiara. You guys did great.
Thank you.
What can people find you, Lauren?
Well, we're seeing everybody remotely virtually right now because of the pandemic, but we are definitely still taking clients. They can reach us at www.cultivateyouressence.com or you can call at 708-654-1929.
Awesome. Yeah. Thank you. My last message is that I hope people realize that mental health is a proactive and not a reactive
measure. Yes. And don't be afraid to really reach out because people are there to help.
Yeah.
And for those of you guys who know people that are struggling with it, have the conversation.
And not be judgmental.
Not be judgmental.
Because that's the biggest thing. You want to have the conversation. One, it helps them to recognize that there is hope out there.
Yeah.
And that they don't have to do it alone. Right. That's my thing.
Yeah. Yeah.
Like you don't have to go through things alone.
Yeah. Yeah.
No matter what it is.
Yeah. Thank you both.
No
Thank you both.
Thank you.
I want to give y'all a hug. Thank you.
Thank you. Of course.
Thank you. You did great. You did great.
Thank you.
If you or anyone you know have had suicidal thoughts, please call the National Suicide Prevention Hotline at 1-800-273-8255. It doesn't mean you're not normal. It means you're human. Your life matters, you matter, and you're loved. See you next time.
Don't you remember you told me you love me, baby? You said you'd be coming back this way. So
and your guitar, and you sound so sweet and clear, but you're not real. It's just the radio. Don't you remember you told me you love me, baby? You said